As previously mentioned, we call a collection of concurrent lines in a plane a pencil of lines, and a collection of collinear points a range. Given three lines of a pencil, we can single out a fourth by the following method. Choose a point in line B, and in it, choose two lines. These give four points in A and C, resulting in two more lines. Where these intersect, draw the fourth line of the pencil. Easy enough so far. But were you expecting this? Repeat the procedure elsewhere on the same three given lines, and you will always get the same fourth line. Note that you can see the one quadrangle as a flip of the other, as an image cast, if you will, through a pinhole. To see why you always get the same fourth line, consider these two triangles. They are clearly perspective from a point. And here is their perspective line. These two are likewise perspective from a point, the same perspective point as before. Where is their perspective line? Since they share two sides each with their gray cousins, two of the intersections of their corresponding sides are the same we just had, which means the third will also lie in the same axis. Now, what about these two here? They cover the brown triangles plus some more territory. No new sides are involved, and only one new corner. Since we are reusing the sides of the other perspective triangles, corresponding sides continue to intersect in the same axis as before. Therefore, these new greenish triangles must also be perspective from a point. And since two pairs of their corresponding corners remain unchanged, so does their perspective point. That is why the new corners must align in the original pencil, which is to say, line D remains unchanged. For any given three lines in a pencil, this quadrangle procedure always singles out the same fourth line. By the way, if you pair the Desargues triangles differently, the quadrangles turn out to have a second axis as well, which in this case lies far off to the left. D is called the harmonic conjugate of B with respect to A and C. Time to polarize. Pause if you want to do so without help. Given three points of a range, we can single out a fourth by the following method. Choose a line in point B, and in it, choose two points. These give four lines in A and C, resulting in two more points. In the line connecting these, mark the fourth point of the range. Easy enough so far. But were you expecting this? Repeat the procedure elsewhere on the same three given points, and you will always get the same fourth point. Note that you can see the one quadrilateral as a shadow of the other, or its reflection. To see why you always get the same fourth point, consider these two trilaterals. They are clearly perspective from a line. And here is their perspective point. These two are likewise perspective from a line, the same perspective line as before. Where is their perspective point? Since they share two corners each with their paler cousins, two of the lines connecting their corresponding corners are the same we just had, which means the third will also lie in the same center. Now, what about these two here? They cover parts of the other trilaterals. No new corners are involved, and only one new side. Since we are reusing the corners of the other perspective trilaterals, corresponding corners continue to align with the same center as before. Therefore, these new green trilaterals must also be perspective from a line. And since two pairs of their corresponding sides remain unchanged, so does their perspective line. That is why the new sides must intersect in the original range, which is to say, point D remains unchanged. For any given three points in a range, this quadrilateral procedure always singles out the same fourth point. By the way, if you pair the Desargues trilaterals differently, the quadrilaterals turn out to have a second center as well, which in this case lies somewhat to the left of the middle of the picture. D is called the harmonic conjugate of B with respect to A and C. You watch geometry on television. Yep. Now, what do harmonic ranges have to do with harmonic pencils? Here is a harmonic range, lying as it must in the sides of a quadrilateral. Draw one more line, and you have a harmonic pencil, for it lies in the corners of a quadrangle, like the harmonic pencils shown at the beginning. And as we have already seen, this is true regardless of which point we choose as the center of the pencil. It could even lie in a different plane, since our proof in the first part of this presentation was based on Desargues' theorem, which holds good in space as well as in the plane. You could choose to see the present picture as three-dimensional. In short, any point connecting with a harmonic range connects with it in a harmonic pencil. Pause if you want to polarize this on your own. Here is a harmonic pencil, lying as it must in the corners of a quadrangle. Mark one more point, and you have a harmonic range, for it lies in the sides of a quadrilateral, like the harmonic ranges shown earlier. And as we have already seen, this is true regardless of which line we choose as the axis of the range. That means any line across a harmonic pencil cuts it in a harmonic range. In other words, harmonic cross ratio is perspectively and hence projectively invariant. We'll introduce projection the time after next. D is called the harmonic conjugate of B with respect to A and C. A and C are corners of a so-called complete quadrilateral, and B and D are the so-called diagonal corners collinear with them. A draftsman's or Renaissance artist's definition of a harmonic range is the vanishing points and the diagonal vanishing points in two-point perspective. For instance, in a drawing of a tiled floor. A and C are sides of a so-called complete quadrangle, and B and D are the so-called diagonal sides concurrent with them. A draftsman's or Renaissance artist's definition of a harmonic pencil is the diagonals and medians of a square, a rectangle, or indeed any parallelogram seen in perspective. But this is the same as to say the lines connecting a point with the vanishing points and the diagonal vanishing points in two-point perspective, which, as we saw, form a harmonic range. We chose A, B, and C without measuring. But D does have a special kind of measure in relation to the other three. Try measuring the distances. Measure AB, CB, which if you measure from left to right is a negative distance, AD, and CD. Every example has different spacing. Yet in every case, AB divided by CB is the same as AD divided by CD, only negative because of the direction of measurement. In other words, harmonic conjugates separate a pair in the same ratio internally and externally, with directions reversed. This is called harmonic cross ratio. In other words, harmonic means the inner proportion and the outer proportion resonate. Harmonic pencils generate the same lawfulness, the same ratio of ratios. However, the previous equation does not work if angles are measured in degrees. Instead, it is customary to cut the pencil with any line and compare the distances between the four intersections. Like this. Or cut the pencil with any line and calculate the areas of the resulting triangles. For precise consistency, count the area of the triangle formed with C and B as negative because of the reversed direction of measurement, or count the other three as negative. If these workarounds feel unsatisfying, and you wish to compare the separation of the lines themselves, you can use the new idea of spread, notated here as S, which Norman Wildberger devised in order to uplift our trigonometry from its current tortured state. Then the corresponding equation holds good. To put it briefly, the spread is the square of the sine. And here too, to be precise, the minus enters the equation when you add the notion of rotational direction. Of course, you can also use sine instead of spread, if you prefer approximations of irrational numbers. Thus, metrical properties result from more fundamental morphological processes. Two points in a line divide it into two segments. One point does not divide a line at all, since you can get to the other side simply by vaulting into hyperdrive and cruising through infinity. Harmonic conjugates divide the inner and outer segments in the same ratio, with directions reversed. When one conjugate approaches one of the points of the original pair, so does the other. When one conjugate moves away from one of the points of the original pair, so does the other. Thus, every point in the inner segment resonates with a point in the outer segment. And conversely. In other words, the two segments are inside-out images of one another. The midpoint of the one segment corresponds to the midpoint of the other. The midpoint of the outer segment is the infinitely distant point of the line. Infinity, the inside-out midpoint. The deeper the inner life, the wider the world. The conjugates keep moving in opposite directions. Likewise, two lines in a point divided into two segments. A segment of a point is the rotating sweep of a line through part of a pencil. These two blue lines separate the black pair harmonically, dividing the inner and outer segments in the same ratio if you compare spread or area. Here too, conjugates move in opposite directions. The midline of the one segment corresponds to the midline of the other. If you are surprised that this sequence does not pass through infinity as the conjugate point in the line did, please remember that in projective morphology, the metric distinction infinitely distant is not singled out for special treatment, as it is in Euclidean geometry. In the present picture, we have another metric Euclidean specialty instead, namely right angles. If one point of a harmonic range is the vanishing point, its harmonic conjugate is the apparent midpoint between the other two. The eye measures differently from the hand. These three fence posts, for instance, are evenly spaced. That is because the vanishing point is the representative in optical space of what the infinitely distant point is in tactile space, namely, the midpoint of the outer segment. And as we saw, the midpoints of the outer and inner segments are harmonic conjugates. Not exactly the Umbrian landscape you would expect in an early Raphael. If one line of a harmonic pencil is the horizon, its harmonic conjugate is the apparent midline between the other two. Here, for instance, we see a photorealistic drawing of a two-lane road, the lanes being equally wide, clearly somewhere in Kansas. Thus, another draftsman's definition of harmonic is: if one of four points in a harmonic range is treated as the vanishing point, then its harmonic conjugate appears to lie midway between the other two. If one of four lines in a harmonic pencil is treated as the horizon, then its harmonic conjugate appears to lie midway between the other two. And if one of four planes in a harmonic pencil of planes is treated as the firmament, then its harmonic conjugate appears to lie midway between the other two.